Well, welcome to OTS 1. Are you happy to be here? Are you happy to be online? I'm happy you're online. I'm happy you're offline. But as long as you are just here tonight, and as long as you are tuned in, listening, and your heart is open and your ears are open, we're going to be talking about a little project that I gave you guys a bit later. But before that, I just wanted to get into tonight's lecture, and then we will get to that part of it. Tonight, lecture 19, allegories and metaphors. The objective for tonight is to explore the allegories found in the book of Numbers and to learn how to apply them to our own lives. Some additional information. The author of the book of Numbers is Moses. You will find this information in your outline at the back of your books or on your notes somewhere. It was written to Israel. It records experiences in the wilderness or the wilderness journey, which are a type of the defeated Christian, which is quite interesting. And then the key verse according to the curriculum is chapter 32 verse 23. But if you fail to do this, you will be sinning against the Lord, and you may be sure that your sin will find you out. Life and ministry principle is God is not pleased with anything less than total commitment. And then you've got the main characters there. If I have to sort of explain the book for me, I've seen this in Christians' lives for 30 years. We're talking about recurring patterns in people's lives. We're talking about people traveling around in circles in their life and not really entering into the promised land. If you look at what Paul said that these things happened to them as examples and were written down as warnings for us on whom the culmination of the ages has come. So Paul says that what we read in the historical texts and even in the prophetic books and the other types of literature that we find in the Old Testament, we find examples and we find warnings. That is why I asked you to actually go and look at Numbers chapter 13 and Numbers chapter 14 and to read through those chapters. And as you read through those chapters and you read about the incidents that happen, when you see something that talks to your heart, that you can find the allegory there, then you actually make a note for yourself and you say, you know what, this is a warning for me. And then you read on and then you say, you know what, this is an example for me. And that is how we learn from the historical text, as we're looking at the warnings and we're looking at the examples. Now, the word Paul uses for examples, this word can be translated as types or little object lessons, or other words known as allegories. Or in the previous lecture, I asked you what an allegory was. And the definition of an allegory, or one of the definitions of an allegory, is an allegory is a story or an event that has a deeper meaning that instructs us morally or spiritually. So when we read the account of Israel leaving Egypt, the Exodus, we see the allegory of us being set free from slavery. Now, in my case, that was slavery of addiction. And we all can identify with that. But here in the desert, as we are at the Jordan, and we are poised to enter into the promised land, we have to ask ourselves if we are willing to follow God's guidance into the promised land, if we are going to be obedient to the point where we can enter in to what God has prepared for us. And you will recall that we spoke about this in a previous lecture. We spoke about the cloud and the guidance of the cloud. It comes into your lecture this week. You will see it on your lecture notes in Numbers 9, 15 to 23. It says that on the day the tabernacle was raised, the cloud covered it. And in the evening, that cloud changed to the appearance of fire and stayed that way through the night. It was always so, the daytime cloud and then changing the appearance to fire at night. When the cloud lifted, the people of Israel moved, and whenever the cloud stopped, the camp stopped. What would you say the allegory is of the cloud today for us? Okay, God's presence and God's instruction.
Only move when he moves.
Only rest when he rests. Holy Spirit. Yes. Holy Spirit. Yes. That's right. So the personal application is, this is a beautiful story that symbolizes the divine guidance, the miracle working power of the Holy Spirit in us, the anointing of the Spirit upon us. Remember what we said, we are living temples. We are the temple of the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit lives within us. Jesus said that, I will send my Spirit and he will stay with you forever. I will not leave you as an orphan. So we have the capacity to hear the Spirit. Now we know Romans 8 says that those who are led by the Spirit, they are the sons of God. It's interesting that he uses the word sonship in connection with being guided. Jesus also says that my sheep knows my voice. So when we look at Israel's movements as the Spirit of God in the form of a cloud lifted, they would move. And when the Spirit of God stopped, they would dead stop, and there they would camp. And there they would remain indefinitely until the Spirit moved again. A lot of times in our lives, we find that we get ourselves into all sorts of trouble because we are moving when we're not supposed to move. Many people these days claim to hear the voice of the Holy Spirit. Many say, the Lord told me. It's interesting in church for so many years as a pastor how you hear the congregation member coming to you and telling you, the Holy Spirit sent me to this church. I have to serve at this church. What can I do at this church? And you say, yes, you can do the children's church or come and work as an usher in the church. And then 3 months later, that same person comes to you and says, the Holy Spirit said I must move now to another church. And you're starting to wonder, you know, can people really hear the Holy Spirit? And this is a critical part of the Christian life. I mean, you're in Bible school. You aspire to function in the kingdom and have a critical, important function that will be judged more harshly, because the leaders are judged at a different level. And you will see that as you look at Numbers and you look at some of the Old Testament text, you will see that leadership is a serious business in the kingdom. And one great requirement for leadership is the anointing, meaning the capacity to function under God's direction, and then the leading of the Holy Spirit, being able to hear what the Holy Spirit is saying to you. And we see this picture here. The Holy Spirit anoints us, indwells us, and fills us just as he did the temple of Solomon. Now, you can ask the question at this stage, if we said, like we said in a previous lecture, they could have completed this journey in 11 days. They were led by the Spirit. Why didn't they go straight into Canaan?
They complained a lot along the way.
Sure. Oh, very true, eh? I mean, if you really read Numbers and you go through the book, it's actually shocking to see how many times the people ended up moving into rebellion. Either rebellion against God, because things weren't going as they wanted it to go. It was either a water problem, a food problem. And sometimes they had food, but they just weren't happy with the food that they got. And then it was a leadership problem. They weren't happy with Moses or what Moses did. And they would attack the leadership that they had. So they kept on complaining. And the problem is the same problem that we have today. God gives the creature he created the freedom to choose. So the Holy Spirit is likened to a dove, a gentle dove. We are told in the New Testament that we must not quench the Holy Spirit, which means the Holy Spirit is not a prominent, dominating spirit. He's not going to come to us, grab us by the neck, and pull us to the will of God. He's going to come like a dove and gently guide us. And if we really understand the personality of God's Spirit and the Spirit as part of the Trinity, we see that the Spirit can be grieved. It says, don't grieve the Holy Spirit with whom you were sealed. So there are many reasons why we don't enter into what God has for us. And it can be blatant disobedience, like we see in the nation of Israel. It can be resistance against God's will. And it can be murmuring, complaining, being negative. And it can be grieving the Holy Spirit and quenching the Holy Spirit when He speaks to us. This is a great lesson for us because being in ministry for so long, you see so much potential in people. And you can really see that God wants to use those people. And God has really placed some purpose, some divine purpose in their lives. You can see the anointing and the capacity that God has given them. But you see it all go to waste because they are traveling in circles. And we have to be very, very careful of that. The other aspect that I want to mention is that if we have the faith to believe and claim the blessing that God has for us and accept His perfect will for our lives, then He can lead us into the promised land. And remember what we said in a previous lecture. We were looking at Romans 12 and verse 2 says that we mustn't conform to the pattern of this world, but we're transformed by the renewing of our minds, that we will be able to test and approve what is the good, the pleasing, and the perfect will of God. So we've got the good, we've got the pleasing, and we've got the perfect will of God. So God has a divine plan for your life, which is called His directive will, where He wants to direct you into this divine plan, which the analogy is Canaan, yeah, the promised land, a land flowing with milk and honey, a land overflowing with God's goodness, a land where you will have to face giants and enemies, but a land where you can possess what God has already provided for you. But then there's also the permissive will of God, where God permits us to operate within our own seat of decision. So we decide. The Lord will not dominate us and control us like robots. He will show us the best that He has for our life, but we will ultimately have to make the decision and the choice. And I mean, think of it. What can be more important in life than reaching the potential that God has placed inside of you? What can be more important in life than releasing what God has placed inside of you into your generation? But the fact of the matter is, we are too alive to self. And the Bible says that we must die to self and live to Christ. It's only in our death that the presence of the Lord is released. It's only in our surrender that God can reach full capacity through our lives. And this life, the seasons that you are facing, the very problems that you are facing, these are all part of this process of actually releasing the presence of the Lord in your life. And the release of that presence means that you've stepped into the promised land. It doesn't mean that you have billions in the bank and you drive the best car and you wear the best clothing. I mean, we believe God supplies all our needs according to His riches and glory. But for us, as we really become hungry for the Lord, as we really cultivate our relationship with God, it becomes more about what He wants. It becomes more about His will. And we develop this real love relationship with our Father, where Jesus says, if you love me, you will obey me. Obedience comes as a result of this real love that we feel for Him. It's not about manipulating God, controlling God, or trying to work the system to the point where we get something out of God, where we're just looking for solutions and we're just looking for this. No, we come to a point where we lay down our lives, Romans 12:1, on the altar, and we say, Lord, we're laying it down now. What do you want? The success of Christianity is not measured in any other way but being able to hear and obey. So in Hebrews 3, verse 7 to 8, we read, so as the Holy Spirit says today, if you hear His voice, do not harden your heart as they did in the rebellion during the time of testing in the wilderness. The Egyptians who had come with them were longing for the good things of Egypt. We had leeks and we had garlic and we had delicacies in Egypt, and we are craving those things now. And these people that traveled with the Hebrews out of Egypt, they were influencing them. And yeah, imagine sitting in a desert and then these Egyptians are sitting here next to you and they're talking about everything they ate there. And all of a sudden, you know, you start salivating at your mouth because you are desiring those things. And as they were desiring those things and that desire was building up, and they were imagining sitting there in Egypt next to the pot with all the meat boiling there and the leeks and the garlic and all the delicacies, they were looking at the manna and they were looking at what they were seeing in their imagination, and all of a sudden they became discontent with their lives. They didn't like it anymore. They didn't want it anymore. And then they started murmuring and brought a plague upon themselves. That's why I said to you in the previous lecture that we have to make sure that we live with an attitude of gratitude always, that we rejoice in the Lord always, that we thank God always for everything. You know, a few years ago, my car broke and I didn't have the money to fix the car. And the guy who had to fix the car quoted me 14,000 rand to fix the car, and I didn't have the money. I couldn't run my business. I couldn't fix the car. I went to a cell church that night and I had to preach at that cell church, and I had to give the guys an encouraging message. And here I was with a car that was broken and I couldn't do my business because of this. And you know what the Holy Spirit said to me that night? He said to me, rejoice about that car. He said, rejoice about the car. It doesn't make sense. The devil came, and what did the devil say? Look at those sinners, those Egyptians. Look what cars they're driving. Look how beautiful their cars are. Look how well it's going with them. Can't your God just supply you with a car? Just something that's got a working engine in? All of those things, that's the things the devil said. Now, if I wanted to go around in circles in the desert, I would have entertained what the devil said, and then I would have started murmuring about the car. Sometimes we even do it in another way. We go into prayer and fasting, which is not wrong. Listen to me, it's not wrong. But if you're going in with the motive of twisting God's arm, you might be doing it the wrong way. So, you know what? I'm going to get this sorted out now. Let me go into prayer and fasting for 21 days. It's not going to work like that. You will only get very hungry. And you'll probably see that God will not do it specifically, not because He doesn't want you to think that you're controlling Him. There's a difference when the Holy Spirit burdens you and you feel, I have to go into a period of travail. I have to go into prayer and fasting. That's different. But if you think that you're going to use your religious knowledge or your knowledge of how God works, figure Him out, and then learn how to twist His arm every now and then to get exactly what you want, it's not going to work like that, because He will not jump when you say jump. He won't. I've known Him for 30 years. I can tell you now. I can promise you. I had to rejoice that night in the cell, and by the end of the cell, I was rejoicing. And you can ask my staff. That next day, the car was driving. The car that had no power, the car that couldn't drive, it was driving. Wasn't perfect, still making a bit of noise and all of that, but it was driving. You know, that car, I'm trying to sell it now, so if you want to buy a car, it's still driving. I can't say if your faith will keep it going, but it's still driving. And I haven't gotten a new car in 14 years. Why? Because God doesn't want to give me a new car? No. Why? Because God can't give me a new car? No. Why? I can't tell you why. I can just tell you that I've learned how to stand in faith for 14 years for a car every morning. So maybe that's worth more than a car. Maybe the lesson that I've learned and the spiritual growth that I've attained is worth more than just getting the car. Maybe the rejoicing of the car would have just lasted for a day or two, but what God has learned me over the last 14 years is going to last me till the day I put my head down and I leave this planet. Maybe what I've gone through with the car is going to train me that when I have to face another battle, I'm going to be battle ready for that battle. Because if God can heal my car, He can heal cancer. He can heal other things that might be known as dreaded diseases. We don't know exactly why certain things work out the way they work out, and we will never know. Sometimes the Lord will give us grace and tell us. But we have to understand that in this life, it is submission to Him and to His will. And whilst we are facing certain things, we better be sure not to fall into what they fell into. Remember, we've got these warnings. We can see what happened to them. Even when they asked for the meat in Numbers 11, God gave them the meat. With the meat came a plague. And I was reading in Psalm 106, verse 14. In the desert they gave into their craving. In the wilderness they put God to the test. So He gave them what they asked for, but sent a wasting disease amongst them. He said to them, listen, I'm going to send you meat until it comes out your nostrils. A lot of times we find that He gives us the desires of our heart, but then we find that the desires of our heart were not right. And then that comes with consequences. So we need to understand that it's important to hear what He says. And the main question here was the desire for Egypt. So they had this love for Egypt that was sort of stuck in their heart, and they kept on going back to Egypt in their minds. They should have forgotten about Egypt, but they kept on going back. God offered them freedom. He offered them the promised land. He offered them total deliverance, but they couldn't receive that because they kept on thinking about Egypt. And that's sort of having that Egypt mentality where you're still thinking about, you know, what you had in the world. But I have found that this world has nothing to offer. Nothing. There's nothing permanent. There's nothing that can compare with Jesus, with the Holy Spirit, and with God. There's nothing. So now we get to the part of the 12 spies. You've got these men. And if you read back in Numbers 11, you will see that there was this time when Moses went and complained to the Lord. And then the Lord actually had 70 elders come forward. And they all received some of the power of the Spirit that was on Moses' life. So I'm assuming that these spies who were the heads of tribes or leaders in tribes, they had part of the Spirit on their life. So it means that even if you are filled with the Holy Spirit and you have the Holy Spirit, it's not a guarantee that you're going to be able to possess what God has for you, because you're going to have to acquire by faith that He provided by grace. So it's going to have to be a belief system. Just looking at a few of the highlights that the Lord showed me, it was the Lord that sent the spies. In Numbers 13:11, the Lord said to Moses, "Send men to explore Canaan, which I'm giving to the Israelites. Send one leader from each of the ancestral tribes." And the Lord commanded Moses to send these men in the desert of Paran. All of them were leaders. So we must assume that the 70 that we see receive power of the Spirit, they were there. That's quite a horrific fact for us to think that having the Holy Spirit, being born again, even receiving the baptism of the Holy Spirit, doesn't guarantee us of entering into the promised land. Entering into the promised land is a decision that you have to make. Based on the new covenant promises that you have to understand. You have to understand what God said. Now here we know God said to Abraham, Isaac and Jacob down the line, He promised this territory. He told them this was a land flowing with milk and honey. And for hundreds of years, this promise was there. And we need to understand at the edge of our promised land, we need to understand once we've overcome the murmuring and the worrying about the food and the rebelling against leaders, and we've overcome all of those things. Now we have to actually have the faith to possess what God has provided for us. But in order to possess that, we have to obviously know what it is. We have to understand. We have to have the revelation of what God has provided for us. This is why Hosea 4:6 says, "My people perish for a lack of knowledge." Jesus says, "You will know the truth, and the truth will set you free." That freedom there doesn't mean freedom from addiction, freedom from drugs, freedom. Yes, it includes that. But the freedom there is that freedom to live in that peace that transcends the understanding, to live at a level where there's literally no devil. And I'm not saying the devil is not attacking, but the devil has no authority, no power, no hold, no foothold in your life, because you're living in a dimension of faith. This is what Paul calls walking by faith and not by sight. Israel walked by sight and not by faith. They were looking at what they saw, not what they heard God said, but what they physically saw. Looking at those giants had the same effect on them that it had on the whole nation of Israel when they were facing Goliath in the valley. It was only David that saw Goliath, but didn't focus on the size of Goliath, but focused on the size of God. He knew his God, so he didn't consider the size of the giant. So for 40 days, they went and they explored the land, and they gave report and they showed the fruit of the land. And they said, "We went to the land where you sent us. It really is a land flowing with milk and honey. Here's some of its fruit." So like you said, they didn't argue that what God had said was the truth. But then there was a but in the story, Numbers 13:28. The but came when they said, "But the people who live there are strong, and their cities have walls, and they are very large. We saw the descendants of Anak there." So there was a but in the story, and they started prepping the people to say to them that, "Listen, these people are strong and their cities are fortified, so physically possible for us to possess the land. In verse 30, Caleb told the people to be quiet and to listen to Moses. Caleb said, "Let's go now and take possession of the land." He was ready to go. "We should be more than able to conquer it." But when the men who had gone with him heard this, they said, "We can't attack those people. They are too strong for us." And this is an interesting section in verse 32. So they began to spread lies among the Israelites about the land they had explored. And then in verse 33, they said, "We felt as small as grasshoppers, and that is how we must have looked to them." You can have everything that God has provided you right next to you without accessing it, because you have to access it by faith. This is the greatest challenge for the church today, it's to access those by faith. Because you have to believe to receive. The righteous will live by his faith, and if he withdraws, the Lord says, "My soul will take no pleasure in him." That is why we are supposed to build ourselves up in our most holy faith. Because when we want to possess the promised land, it's done by faith. Because with our physical eyes, we're going to see the giants. They're going to be bigger. We're going to see the walls, and it's going to be too high for us. We're not going to be able to do it. It's going to be impossible in the natural. God says, "There's your promised land. Go and possess it." Physically, you look at it with the natural, it will not be possible. Then you have to look into the spiritual and then take it by faith and then move. This is what the difference was with Caleb and with Joshua. They had a different spirit. You will see that in Numbers 14, I think it's 24. There was a different spirit. Why? Because they followed God wholeheartedly. The reason that many Christians today are sitting on the edge of the promised land is because they follow God half-heartedly. Exactly the opposite. Half-heartedly, not wholeheartedly. The power of Christianity is in death and resurrection. Am I right? Resurrection power. Resurrection power can only come in death. Death can only come in absolute surrender. Absolute surrender is an indication of wholeheartedly following God. And that is where the power is released, because it's in that death to self where a supernatural power of faith comes into us, where we can actually possess things that are impossible for us in the natural to possess. So God will always give you a vision. He will always give you a dream that is impossible for you to do and to fulfill and to conquer. Your destiny will be much greater than you. But if you could do it, it would not be God. But the fact that you can't do it, it's going to have to be God. He chose fishermen. He chose tax collectors and sinners. And he didn't go for the top notch. But those men changed the entire world. They literally turned the world upside down by the power of the Holy Spirit, moving in faith, moving in power. There's this interesting section where Caleb, at the age of 85, after they crossed the Jordan, after they possessed the promised land, after the entire generation died, at the age of 85, he actually went to Joshua and he said, "Listen, let me now go and possess the land that Moses gave me." This man was 85 years old. And even at 85, He said to Joshua, I'm feeling as strong as I felt back then when I said we can take these giants, and now I'll go take those giants. And at 85, he still waited 45 years, and then he went to go face those giants. With God, nothing is impossible. When you look at impossible, that's where God starts. So you might be sitting with an impossible problem, impossible issue, impossible thing in your life, but with God, nothing is impossible. The word impossible does not exist. The devil wants you to believe that it's impossible, but with God, it's not. The final section I want to just briefly discuss tonight deals with the serpent that Moses had to put on the stick in Numbers 21. What do you know about the bronze serpent? Complainers, snake bites. They spoke against God and against Moses and said, why have you brought us out of Egypt to die in the wilderness? There is no bread, there is no water, and we detest this miserable food. Then the Lord sent venomous snakes amongst them. They bit the people and many of the Israelites died. The good news was that Moses then, under instruction of the Lord, created this bronze serpent that he put upon a pole, and everybody who looked upon the bronze serpent were healed from their snake bites. Now many snake-bitten gripers doubted God's questioning how looking at a piece of brass could possibly heal their snake bites. So many of them died because they didn't believe that looking at a bronze serpent on a pole could actually heal them from snake bites. What allegory do we see here with this bronze serpent? Jesus on the cross. So yes, in John 3:14, Jesus said, as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, even so must the Son of Man be lifted up, so that whosoever believes will in him have eternal life. So this was a type of Christ. The poisonous snakes represent the results of our sins. Just as the Israelites were healed upon looking at the bronze serpent, so we are healed when we look upon Christ. He healed us of our poisonous sins. He is our salvation. So what we share tonight is basically this nation poised to enter into the promised land, at the edge of the promised land, literally probably a few hundred meters away from entering into what God provided for them. But because of unbelief, they could not enter in. They couldn't believe that God could give them the promised land. They went physically into the promised land. They saw it with their eyes. They had a revelation of what the promised land was, a full revelation. They saw everything that God had promised to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, that they knew from childhood. They saw it in the promised land. So they knew it was there. They knew it existed. God had taken them through a desert. He had brought them to the edge of it. They had physically seen it. They had probably, in the 40 days, they had consumed the fruit and the fruit of the land. They had seen it all, but they couldn't get past the limitations of their eyes, because they saw the giants, they saw the fortified walls of the cities, and they just couldn't believe that there was any way that God could give it to them, because they didn't see a way of accessing it. They saw it was there, but they couldn't see a way of accessing it. And that is where faith comes in our lives. We know it's impossible to please God without faith. And we know that faith cometh by the word and the hearing of the word. So as we take in God's word, as we attend Bible school, as we read our Bibles, we build ourselves up in faith. And as we start acting upon God's word and we start seeing God's hand move in certain areas of our lives, it reinforces our faith, and we grow in our faith every single day until we can possess what God has given us and what God has for us. That's already been provided for us. It's already there. We just need to acquire it. So the first lesson was the murmuring, the complaining, the rebellion, the dissatisfaction. The second lesson was the limitations of not being able to believe, unbelief. Looking and saying, well, we can't do it.